this is a familiar sight in many developing countries. And if you were to ask the question, what's wrong with this picture? The first thing that people would say is there's too much congestion. It's too many vehicles on the road and the vehicles don't have any room to grow, to move. Now, it turns out that if you actually pay closer attention to this picture, you start to see that the bulk of the people are actually traveling in these buses on the roads, and a few in two-wheelers. In the cars and other private vehicles, you actually have fewer vehicles, fewer persons, and they end up taking a lot of the road space. So it's congestion is not really the problem. Access turns out to be the problem. Transport is really a means to serve our needs for access to goods and services. So if we keep focusing on the problem of mobility and congestion, we're actually missing the larger picture around transport. The transport problem has largely been ill-defined in terms of how many kilometers or passenger kilometers need to be accommodated. But the real question is, how do people access their place of work? How do they end up getting their goods and services? How do they send their children to school, and so on? And these problems are actually solvable through a mixture of the network of roads and modes through which transport is organized, and the way in which land use itself is organized. And so that's a rather complex, integrated problem, but it's not usually seen as such. In India, the barriers to access have largely got to do with the fact that there's poor pedestrian and bicycle facilities, a lack of independent grade-separated lanes for public transport, and bad conditions for intermodal changes. So that even if you have systems like the metro and train stations and so on, there's very poor connections between train stations and other modes. And people usually have to walk or take a bus to get to a metro station, and those connections and those services are very poorly organized. In an ideal case, the livable street would look something like this, where you have a variety of features that are very, very significant. First of all, you would have wide sidewalks, and wide sidewalks are important because the bulk of the people would need to walk, and this facilitates the use of a mode of transport that takes up the least amount of energy, is actually good for you, and reduces traffic on the roads as a result. If more people were to walk, there'll be less traffic on the roads, especially for short distances. A second feature would be the what I'd mentioned earlier, having mixed uses, mixed land uses. So you have houses and shops and commercial establishments and other features close to each other, so you don't have to travel very far, and you could essentially walk to those places. You would also have safe crosswalks for pedestrians. Again, a pedestrian-oriented street design would change the quality of transport, the quality of life on the streets. And then you have exclusive bus lanes. In this case, you have a lane that's grade separated. You see these barriers so that the buses are not impeded, as in the previous picture, by other vehicles. And then you also have exclusive bicycle lanes over here. And that provides access to another sustainable mode of transport, namely a non-motorized mode of transport, namely bicycling. And then you have your cars having less road space, certainly, but only those who absolutely need to use cars would use them in any case. So the question is, can we get from the image that I showed you over here to here? And this is not a straightforward issue. It requires changes in technology, requires changes in planning, changes in attitudes about planning, and of course also some changes in lifestyles. In terms of technology, bus rapid transit, which involves the use of buses having exclusive and grade separated lanes, has been a very successful experiment around the world, particularly in Latin America, but also many parts of Asia, including in India. And this requires human scale engineering for grade separation. In terms of planning, we need to focus on mixed use land use growth and something known as transit oriented development, that is planning cities so that around transit, planning cities around bus stops, bus stations, train stations, and so on. And the third feature would be what's known as intermodalism, making sure that the connections between these different modes, buses and trains, allowing bicycles on the trains and buses is one way of promoting intermodalism, and so on. And certainly making sure that you have wide enough pedestrian sidewalks so that people have access to these different public transit modes. And finally, lifestyles. So we certainly need a change in attitudes from a sort of some privileging private vehicles to believing that walking and bicycling are good for health in cities, and that is in fact borne by the evidence, by scientific evidence. The focus needs to start at the bottom end, on the poorest and neediest users. So planners need to really think around who their neediest users are rather than who their elites are. And as I mentioned earlier, there tends to be a focus on the needs of the elites, whereas that really needs to be reversed. It's upside down. We need to really focus on the needs of the neediest people. Now, cities tend to have different networks, different ways in which transport systems need to be organized, and the traditional city used to be called a monocentric kind of city, where there's a central business district and people used to live further out, and all of them used to end up coming to the CBD. And that's the way in which many cities were planned in the early and mid parts of the 20th century. But that's changed quite a bit to these different patterns. The polycentric pattern is one where you have multiple centers and the CBD is just one among many, and people may end up going to those other centers. You also have one where the CBD is even smaller and people could be traveling across to multiple centers and living elsewhere. And then you have what's known as the monopolycentric model, where you have a strong tendency towards a CBD, but you also have a lot of simultaneous random movements across other places on the outskirts or away from the CBD. Now, there's some rules of thumb about planning for public transport. A person who can walk for up to 12 minutes can easily should easily be able to reach any point in an area of 100 hectares. A job or a shop located in an area with a density of 10 per persons per hectare can be reached by about 1,000 people without requiring motorized trips. But 30,000 people can reach the same job within walking distance if the density is around 300 people per hectare. Now, it turns out that a typical Asian city has a very high density, and planning should therefore make it much easier for people to reach their destinations by walking alone. So walking and bicycling typically ought to be sufficient for the bulk of a city's population in Asian cities, but clearly that's not happening, partly or largely because the infrastructure has not been designed around bicycling and walking. Another feature, apart from density, is really how the streets themselves are laid out and how they're connected to one another. If you see a pattern like this, the one on top, you have a more or less gridded pattern, and this facilitates along the arteries, especially the use of buses and other public transport links. And within these blocks, it might be possible to walk, to cycle, or if you're elderly or disabled, to have neighborhood vehicles, transit vehicles, or what's known as paratransit, to take you to the respective places. Now, if you have the suburban kind of design, the typical suburban design in the United States, where you have a large number of cul-de-sacs and so on, it makes it very difficult for public transport to actually reach those places. So that's a real challenge in planning. So it's not just density, but also the way the network is organized that matters for planning. Now, in many parts of South Asia, many Indian cities in particular, you have a declining role for public transport, and this is partly because of growing prosperity on the part of users, but mostly because of poor planning, and so where people who are transit dependent are forced to spend long times in buses, and usually out of frustration, the first thing they do is buy a two-wheeler. So the growth of two-wheelers is quite striking. If you look at the case of Bangalore, and this is the green, the olive green segment, and you see a huge growth in two-wheelers, largely because public transport has not grown in capacity and in the network keep up with the needs of the city. So I mentioned that automobility or the automobilized cities is a challenge associated with sprawl, and we can make a contrast between what automobilized cities look like versus what sustainable transport and sustainable cities might look like. So in automobilized cities, you have subsidies for motor fuel, for parking and land use, road use, largely because there's very little, parking fees, even when they're imposed, tend not to reflect the true costs of using up that road space or the city space for parking. There tends to be a focus on capacity expansion of roads and an overall neglect of local street and sidewalk maintenance. So walking and bicycling are de-emphasized and cars are overemphasized. And motor vehicle traffic and parking displaces cyclists, pedestrians, public transport and parks, right? In sustainable cities, cities that have sustainable transport, there you generally have subsidies for public transport, and subsidies for public transport, especially capital subsidies, are very important. Many successful public transport systems around the world are able to meet their operational costs, but not necessarily the capital costs. And that should be recognized and that should be promoted, because public transport provides an enormous service and vastly reduces the emissions associated with transport. So there should also be subsidies for cycling and affordable housing that's close to public transport, and this is what I referred to earlier as transit-oriented development. Modernization of roads with real-time traffic management and operation, this is also something that is important. And then road space protected for pedestrians, cyclists, and the presence of public space. In other words, when cities are made pedestrian friendly and cyclist friendly, and there's lots of green space, it's more likely that people will be out on the streets. They'll be improve their social life and have greater levels of leisure than if they were stuck in traffic, in cars or private vehicles, and they have no options for these alternatives. Now, in developing countries, as I mentioned, public transport is often overcrowded, poorly maintained, unsafe and slow. It is also inadequate in industrialized countries, where urban spaces become automobile friendly but unsuitable for walking. Unmanaged sprawl and urbanization also something that you see in both developing and developed countries. And usually you have weak governance structures for transport and land use planning management, particularly in the developing world, and very little attention to equality of access among different social and economic groups. As I mentioned earlier, the emphasis has been on pleasing the elites who demand private roads, who demand less congestion, demand easier access for their automobiles, and this all takes place at the expense of the poor and the needy. Sustainable transport, on the other hand, bus rapid transit and rail on high demand corridors would be something that you would see. You would also have performance-based contracting, meaning, in other words, if you have private operators for these systems, they would be paid on the basis of how well they perform, not on how many passengers they carry. So there are some subtle ways in which you can actually improve the quality of service through contracting, rather than see those systems decline just because you have poorly managed contract. Public transport oriented development, or transit oriented development, I already mentioned this, and stronger governance structures for transport and land use policy. So land use policy and transport have to be integrated. They shouldn't be dealt with as having separate governance structures. And this is very important, because if you think about transport, the need for transport is really the need for access, not the need for mobility. And certainly more equitable access for the poor, the disabled, young and old.